brothers, sisters, yes, even one's own self, can't be my disciple. Anyone who won't shoulder his own cross and follow me can't be my disciple. Is there anyone here who, planning on to build a house, doesn't first sit down and figure out the cost so you know if I can complete it? If you only get the foundation laid and then run out of money, you're going to look pretty foolish. Everyone passing by will poke fun at you. He started something he couldn't finish. Or can you imagine a king going into battle against another king without first deciding whether it's possible with his 10,000 troops to face the 20,000 troops of the other? And if he decides he can't, he won't send an emissary to work out a truce? Simply put, if you're not willing to take what is dearest to you, whether plans or people, and kiss it goodbye, you can't be my disciple. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. Notice where I'm standing for the sermon. Up front. We have a full house today. Welcome, everybody, to St. Mark's. Welcome, lifelong and longtime members. Welcome, newer members. Welcome, visitors and friends of St. Mark's, people that haven't been here in a while. Welcome, everyone. Now, last Sunday, I preached on welcoming people to the table, especially those who tend to not be welcomed by others. Not only are we to welcome all to the table, but to give up our good seats at the table. And today, Jesus talks about giving up again. But this time, it's really giving things up. But before we talk about that, I think it may be helpful to get a little bit of context why Jesus is pushing giving up. And it goes way back when Israel is about to enter the promised land after liberation from slavery in Egypt. And Moses tells Israel this. This is from the Message translation. This is what we heard in the first reading. If you have a change of heart, refuse to listen obediently, and willing to go off to serve and worship other gods, you will most certainly die. You won't last long in the land that you are crossing the Jordan to enter and possess. I call heaven and earth to witness against you today. I place before you life and death, blessing and curse. Choose life, so that you and your children will live and love God, your God, listening obediently to him, firmly embracing him. And yes, he is life itself, a long life settled in the soil that God, your God, promised to give your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That day, Moses urges Israel to walk into the way of life and hold fast to God, either choose life or death. Choose blessings or choose curses. Israel is to trust in the God who liberated them from slavery in Egypt, the same God who guided them through wilderness on their way to the promised land. They needed to give up their trust in false gods and place their trust and faith in God. Trust in the God who will defend them, protect them, and provide for them. If we choose life, we reject death. You know, death brought on by spiritual enslavement, ignorance, greed, and fear. But more often than not, though, we end up choosing death. We hold on to things. We hoard things which promote death, not life. Have you seen the TV show about hoarders? Is that a yes? Why does that TV show always come on when I'm eating? And why don't I turn it off? You know, there's family members who try to release their loved ones from hoarding. Hoarding is a disease which buries its sufferers. Have you seen how people can't walk through houses? They're literally buried in their house. Hoarders cannot part with the tiniest of possessions. It's like, I need this paperclip. They can't part with it. They get to the point where all of that stuff turns into piles of junk, and then it turns into garbage. Mountains of garbage taking over lives. This is not life. This is death. God watches us hoard. God knows the destructive power of hoarding. God has watched us throughout history gather all that we can, money, possessions, power, fame, privilege. I'm going to gather it all for myself. It's all about me. And we drown in all that stuff. We say we follow Jesus, but how can we follow Jesus when we are up to our necks with our stuff and ourselves? How can we follow Jesus when we follow the stuff we've hoarded and watch it grow and grow and grow? Our trust is in our stuff, ourselves. We find comfort in our junk, whether it's spiritual or literal junk. We trust our junk. Junk has become our God. This God doesn't bring life. This God enslaves us, distracts us, burdens us, alienates us from others. All it brings is death. Do you know St. Mark's mission statement? Kind of. I always have to look online or go in the library and look. I can never remember it. Let's read it together. Following Jesus, growing in Jesus, connecting others to Jesus and his work. What are the first two words? Following Jesus. Click ahead. Following Jesus. Not junk. Not other self-centered false gods. Not death. Not ourselves, but Jesus. And the paradox is this. We follow Jesus, we choose life, right? But we need to die, too. Now, I'm not talking about end-of-life, heart-stopping death. I'm talking about death to all the things that distract us from life. We're to die to those things which stand between human beings, getting along with each other, loving and trusting each other. Things that stand between Republicans and Democrats, for example. Between conservative and liberal, between citizen and immigrant, between white, black, Native American, Asian, Latino, between Christian and Muslim and Jew, between gun owner and not gun owner, between straight, gay, lesbian, bisexual, transgender. I could go on for days. All these things which stand between each other are the things that stand between me and Christ. Between you and Christ, between us and Christ. If we call ourselves Christians, followers of Jesus, all those things have to die. Our attachment to all that we've hoarded has to die. Jesus says so directly in today's gospel reading. Simply put, if you're not willing to take what is dearest to you, whether plants or people, and kiss it goodbye, you can't be my disciple. This is where Jesus drops the mic, walks off the stage, bam. You can kiss it goodbye. You can't be my disciple. Well, have no fear, my fellow members in Christ. You don't have to do it alone. You don't have to figure it out alone, because we have each other. We have Christ to show us the way. We have the Holy Spirit to give us faith and the strength to do it. Today, together, we choose life. And we bring that life out into the world. We must not hoard that life for ourselves here at St. Mark's. That life is not just for us. It's for the world, because the world needs it, people, desperately. Remember, Christ didn't keep life for himself. He gave it up for you and me and the entire race. For without the death of Christ, life means nothing. And for without the death of our hoarding, our attachments, our self-centeredness, life means nothing. So today we begin by bringing that life out into the world with today's service projects. Together, we will be assembling backpacks with school supplies for Lutheran World Relief. We're going to sort and organize winter wear for our giveaway in October. We are bringing life out into the world because that life is not ours to keep. It is ours to share. So choose life with me today, dear friends. Die with me today, followers of Christ, because life is so good. Amen. So before we sing this hymn, ELCA put out a hymn contest for God's Work Our Hands Sunday, which is today. Here's that hymn that won. If you're